with us and answer questions. Uh-oh.
Wait, is the sound off?
Hi.
All right, I'm here.
Okay, so are we. So I just introduced you.
All right.
And so you go ahead and you can get started.
All right. Do we have a slideshow?
Yep, I can pull that up right now.
The first main slide. All right. So I heard you all are interested in what developmental biology is in general. So what do you think developmental biology is? Do you have any idea?
John?
Anyone?
Speak up.
The development of limbs and embryos, maybe.
Did you hear that?
Yes, I did. Development of limbs and embryos. Okay. Can you tell me more generally what that would be?
The development of life in embryos? Or just the development of life?
Well, that's maybe too general.
Oh. Wait.
The development of organisms?
Yes. So, what we generally consider development is how organisms grow, but in a period before they're born or before they're hatched from an egg, right? So if Ms. Kaufmann can put me the second slide. So on this first slide, you see various baby animals, right?
Yes.
Now,
yeah.
This second slide. And on this second slide, I'm showing you how these babies look like before they're born or hatched. So if I ask you, can you guess which one is which, what would you say? Would you even say?
No.
Could you predict which was which?
No. Maybe the one on the furthest left?
Maybe the one on the furthest left?
The smallest.
Yes.
What do you think that might be if I go back?
That's the chick. That's the chick.
Do you know what axolotl is?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, you do? Okay. So, axolotls, I currently work with axolotls.
Whoa.
And axolotls in nature you can find in one lake near Mexico City in Mexico. And what is cool about them is, so axolotl first means the water monster. What is cool about it is that they can, if you cut off their limbs, they can regrow back the limb. And not only that, even if you do something like taking their eyeballs, they can also regrow eyeballs. Those are really cool animals.
Yep.
But we can talk later about those. Okay, so it's kind of difficult to guess, right?
Yeah.
So if we go to the third slide, that stage on the third slide, you will see that's a bit older in what we call embryonic development. Does that give you any more clues than the previous slide?
Yep.
Yeah.
How?
Some of them look like fish.
If you heard that, they said some of them look like fish.
And
which ones?
The ones on the left.
One of them kind of looks like an elephant.
On the left, they're saying?
Yeah, all the way to the left.
Okay.
On the left, one of them looks like it has the stuff from an axolotl.
Yeah.
All right, so we're getting there.
The scruff.
Okay. Yeah, so do you know what, when axolotls have these like hair like, do you know what that is?
Antennae?
The what?
No, I don't know.
Well, what do you think?
Well, anyone has an idea?
Milton, what did you say?
Instincts.
Their instincts?
The gills?
These things?
We're in.
Okay.
Gills. Who said gills?
Fernando.
All right, Fernando. That's a good guess. Those are external gills for axolotls. Now, axolotls are amphibians, but they live submerged in water, and they have a bit of lungs, but they mainly breathe through the gills. All right. Okay. So if we can go to the next slide, those are even older embryos of these creatures.
Does it look more familiar now?
Oh, yeah.
Alright, okay, so I think the next slide has the name as well.
Okay, does that match your predictions, you guys?
Yes.
Alright, so I think the one after that has a one-to-one matchup with the little ones, the babies from the first slide. Right, so what you see from this is that early embryonic stages, so very early once the organism starts to develop, they look very much alike. And you can't tell a human apart from a fish embryo, right? So what developmental biologists do, they try to figure out what are the commonalities during embryonic development and what are the differences. So that's basically what we do. And these drawings that you saw, those drawings are from the 19th century, from a biologist called Ernst Haeckel. He is the one, not necessarily the first one, but he described in details how this is the case, that early developmental stages are very much alike among different animals. And in modern developmental biology, we more look at how genes control these processes. Right. So, I heard that you have some questions for me on how do you go from one cell to trillion cells, right?
Yeah.
That was someone's question.
Yes.
Right, well, have you heard of the process called mitosis?
Yes.
Yes.
Some have. We haven't taught it.
Okay.
In this class, yeah.
All right, and do you know what chromosomes are?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, who can tell me what a chromosome is?
Cece, what do you think? What a chromosome is? No?
Sorry.
Never mind.
Okay,
wait. Like cells that make up your DNA, possibly? Not cells. Snacks?
Parts and things that make up your cell, that makes up your DNA.
So, something to do with DNA.
Yep.
That's a good start. That's a good start. So, what happens in a cell? Cell has, you know, the membrane and the cytoplasm. You learn about that, and it has a nucleus.
Yeah.
And in the nucleus, there's DNA. Now, DNA are these long, thin threads, like kind of ball of threads in the nucleus. However, there are 46 of those threads. And 23 came from your mom, and 23 came from your dad, right?
Yes.
And now in the process of mitosis, you wanna split this one cell into two cells, but each cell has again have 23 threads of DNA from mom, and 23 threads from your dad. Now, what's problematic here is that DNA is this long and thin threads, and it's kind of, imagine that you have knitting yarn, and they're all tangled in this, all different colors of yarn, tangled. And now you want to split different colors. Would it be easy to try to pull out the thread and do it like that? Or can you think of a smarter idea, smarter way to do it?
To untangle them.
Cut them apart, just follow one color.
Follow one color, cut them apart.
Yeah.
So, we don't want to cut up the DNA, we want to make them intact. But what you can do is roll one color in a ball, right? And then once you have multiple colored balls, it's easy to separate them, right?
Yes.
So very similarly, it would be DNA in a cell. Instead of having these long threads, you will condense them, and each thread will make one chromosome. So in a way, a chromosome is kind of transportational form of DNA to handle it within cells in an easier way. So once you have 46 of them, you can easily say, okay, one in one cell, the other in the other cell. And you go like that. So that's what chromosomes are. But you are right, they are mainly made of DNA. Now, do you know what DNA is, or what is whole organism. So all your bodies are made of cells, and each one of your cells has a full instruction how to build a human being. And if you have a pet, like a cat or dog, or even goldfish, each of their cells has a full information on how to build a cat or a dog or a goldfish. Now you may be asking, well, okay, there are different types of cells in one's body, right? You have skin cells, you have cells in your eye, you have lung cells, brain cells, and so on. And all these cells do different things, right? So why would each cell have a full information on how to build a whole body? Like, why would a lung cell know how to also build an eye, right? That kind of makes no sense. Now, this is because we all start from a single cell, fertilized egg, and that has to have all the information to build a human. But then, as the cells divide and go from one to two and then to four and so on, each cell maintains this full information until it comes the moment where cells need to decide what they will become. Will they be lung cells? Will they be brain cells? And so on. And the way they decide that, they access genes or parts of this information that tell them how to build an eye, a lung, and so on. Right? So this process we call differentiation. We call cells differentiate or decide what will they be. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Alright. So maybe if we can go for the last slide that I have for you. What do you think? So this is none of the creatures that you saw so far, but could you guess which creature is this?
No.
Embryo, which animal?
Is it the same animal for all these embryos?
No, this is a different one. You haven't seen that animal yet.
But are all these images from one species?
It is one species, yes.
Okay.
It's some vertebrate.
Oh,
that's a vertebrate.
Oh.
A mouse?
I think it's
some
sort of vertebrate.
Oh, yeah, it might be the funny.
Vertebrate for sure. That's good.
I'm gonna say mouse.
And I hear mouse. I hear
mouse.
I say mouse.
Yeah, mouse.
Rodent.
Shit.
Okay, I hear rodent.
A spider.
A dog.
So do spiders have backbones?
A cat? Maybe a
mammal?
Cat?
I mean, who's to say?
Is sort of mammal?
A bear.
Bear?
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you think it would be easy to get so many bear embryos?
No.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
You're right. So you were generally right. Those are mouse embryos.
Yeah.
Mouse females usually are pregnant for 21 days, and this is halfway through. These embryos are 10 and a half days old. And as you can see, there are various blue colors, blue color on various parts of the embryo, right? So you can see how future vertebrae are labeled. Those are the blue colors along the back. And then you can see there are little buds on the side. Those are called limb buds that will be future arms and legs, right? Now, the blue color, mouse embryos are not usually blue. That is just our scientific way of labeling certain things. And you can also see on each image there is CE and the number, right? So this CE and whatever the number is, each of these elements, that's also a DNA element that instructs those cells that they should build a limb or a brain. For example, there is a CE64. That one has a big staining blue mouse cells how to build a brain. And then there are, for example, CE62, that one has a staining in the eye, right?
Yep.
And also the limb bud, this thin layer, thin blue layer in the limb bud. So this is the way that we determine how these cells will become an eye, a limb, and so on.
Sorry, I missed that because I was just talking to a student briefly. But so all the numbers correspond to which?
To different elements that instruct basically those cells, partially at least, how to build different parts of the body.
Okay.
And we see this by the staining in these different parts of the body.
Okay, I understand.
This is what I did for my doctoral thesis. All those embryos, I detected all these animals, all these elements. All
right. Is 49 a control or 76?
Let me see. No, some of these elements, let me see, 49.
Or I see it, it's on the vertebrae.
49 has a bit of on the vertebrae.
Okay.
I don't see it on
something. And 75 has a little bit in a brain, the big part.
Sorry.
Sometimes those elements are not very strong in what they're doing. That's why they need another element that complements them in the same part of the body.
When you say element, do you mean groups of cells?
No, the DNA element. Okay. Part DNA, part of the chromosome.
Okay, got it.
All right. Well, how about you ask me a question what you want to know? I think I talked myself enough. Please, go ahead.
Somebody has more or less than 46 chromosomes, or is that even possible?
Of course, yes. So it very much depends what kind of a creature you are. For example, in plants, plants can tolerate this very, very well. In fact, have you ever eaten what we call wild strawberries? Those very tiny ones that are very fragrant, right? Yeah. Okay, so that's kind of a original type of a strawberry. But the one that you buy in the supermarket, they're really huge, right?
Yeah.
So what happened over the course of centuries is that the chromosome number in the original strawberry doubled and quadrupled. And the strawberry that you buy in the supermarket has not 2 times the DNA, but diploid still, but 8 times. It's octaploid. And usually in plants, if you multiply the number of chromosomes, fruit of those plants usually gets bigger. And this is what agriculture people who, selected plants for food, they went for it. And they only recently, relatively recently figured out that that's the reason why many fruits are so big. Now, if we talk about animals can't really tolerate this very well. So, have you heard of people who have Down syndrome?
Yeah.
Right. So, those people have chromosome number 21 three times.
Hmm.
So, instead of one from mom and one from dad, they would have one of each and then one extra either for mom or for dad. And those people usually have particular facial features, and sometimes people with a duplication, or if a chromosome is less, less 45, they would have certain mental problems, right? So what is important in cells is that the amount of DNA is maintain at the same level, because if you have one chromosome extra, then you are producing and that's too much for cell to handle. The same goes if you lack a chromosome, then you don't produce enough what cell needs to produce, right? Do you know that the difference between, in humans at least, males and females, boys and girls, is that girls have these two X chromosomes,
yeah,
and boys have X and Y chromosome, right?
Yeah.
Right. So we have 22 pairs, and then the 23rd pair is be different. It's different in boys than in girls. But what happens, you want to have a balance. So boys would have one X and one Y. Girls would have two X's, but usually one X would be kind of, we say, attenuated or inactive, or, you know, shut down a little bit. And that's how we maintain the balance, because whatever X chromosome instructs the cell to produce, it has to be the same between boys and girls. The only difference basically comes from Y chromosome. Y chromosome doesn't hold, it's a very small chromosome, and it doesn't hold too many instructions. But those instructions are how to build a boy. Because when you all were embryos, in that very early, early stage, where you're indistinguishable from frogs and fish, right? You would generally all become girls. But if there is a Y chromosome, those embryos will become boys. So that's what normally happens to balance the amount of instruction in the cell. And then, of course, if you have, again, one chromosome more, one chromosome less, that breaks that balance. And then as a consequence, you see people, for example, with Down syndrome.
And is
Does
there,
that answer your question?
Yes.
And is it random in females that certain X chromosome, like in any given cell, a different X chromosome can be inactivated from another cell?
You mean the X chromosome?
Yes.
Yes, so very early on, even pre-embryo stage, when cells only divide, X chromosome in each cell, a random one will be active, inactivated. And for example, if some women have a mutation on one of those chromosomes, for example, there is a condition that you don't have sweat glands on certain parts of your body. And then in females who have this problem, certain parts of the body will have sweat glands. Those are the normal X that are active. But if normal X was inactivated and the mutant X is active in those cells, those patches of skin will not have sweat glands. So this would manifest or show as some parts of female skin be bright red because they can't cool it down. That can happen, for example. This is not the number of chromosome abnormality, but if the, you know, the mutant one is not inactivated, this can then be visible, for example.
Another question. Everyone in here has a question in front of them. Any questions that you're burning to ask? Let's start with the good ones, because we only have 15 minutes left. John?
So through some sort of weird mutation or something, could humans develop a tail?
Did you hear that? Could humans develop a tail? Or do humans?
Well, if you remember those first, their early embryos, you can actually see that there is something like a tail, right? So those cells in humans are programmed to die. However, sometimes this program in a cell, in cells that need to die, doesn't function. And then sometimes babies are born with this rudiment tail. Sometimes in films you can see that. Okay, kind of weird creatures. So there are two ways that problems can occur. Either something doesn't function as it should, or it kind of functions too much. It's kind of a two ways to deal with. For example, tumors, right? So the characteristic of a tumor is that cells divide and divide uncontrollably. And there are two mechanisms that can be problematic. Either one mechanism is that allows cells to divide too much, so that's the mechanism that should stop them, is not active. Or there are mechanisms that allow blood vessels to grow into tumor that will then feed tumors, right? They don't prevent this from happening. That's, for example, another problem, another genetic problem. Because tumors in general are genetic problems. There are mutations on gene chromosomes that then either overfunction or underperform. So it's a similar thing with rudiments, like tails, or sometimes people will be born with like little skin between their fingers. You know, it will look like frogs. So if you remember those embryos, they all have like little buds coming from the side of the body, right? They're just round, and as the limb grows, cells in between future fingers need to die. But sometimes that mechanism doesn't work, and then kids are born either with completely fused fingers, or there's a, like a little rudiment, little skin in between.
Colton?
So is evolution determined by like altered like DNA almost? Like, is DNA adaptive?
So the question is DNA adapt? I think the question is generally about evolution. You know what? We're going to talk about evolution and the process of evolution, and I can explain the essential variation involved with that in the selection.
Yes, but the question is touching the right point. It will be generally considered that changes in DNA are kind of the first step. Now, those changes, it doesn't matter if it happens in, for example, cells of your skin. What matters is that changes are inherited to the offspring, which means changes in germinal cells, eggs and sperm. Those will transfer the genetic material to the offspring, and those changes will count. So that's for the most part, the basis of evolution on molecular level.
Fernando?
All
right.
Why are some people born with extra body parts?
Like what kind of extra body parts?
Fingers.
Extra fingers and toes.
Extra fingers and toes definitely can happen. So the work that I did for my doctoral studies actually studied a gene or instruction, and this gene, among other things, control limb development, and that if something goes wrong with that gene, you can have multiple fingers or lack of certain fingers, or it can be multiple fingers that are fused together. Now you have like, let's say, 10 fingers on one hand fused together, and sometimes it's easy to surgically remove the skin in between, but sometimes it remains like that. And sometimes it's even different in single person. One arm, let's say, lacks middle fingers, and the other arm is relatively okay. So it even depends on which side of the body it is. So that's extra body parts. What else? Well, we already talked about tails. Sometimes it happens that heart in babies is not split in two atriums and two ventricles, but the septum, the shelf in between, is not fully formed. And that separation of heart in two halves is the basis of warm bloodedness in animals. So if, let's say, if humans can't do it, you kind of are on the verge of being cold-blooded animal, like fish or reptilians, for example. It's thing of reptilians, sometimes people have a rudiment of a, like a third eyelid.
Oh, really?
This you might recognize. Yeah, the rudiments just, not like the full third eyelid, but whatever you may be seeing in like Spider-Man or things like that don't really normally exist. It is usually more rudimental.
Like,
so the what is that? Spider-Man's enemy is this guy with multiple tentacles, right? That you would be hard pressed to have such a human form.
Like, how do conjoined twins form, basically?
Conjoined twins, how do they form?
I think like it's kind of like a
That's a good question. So usually the way twins happen are two ways. Either there are two egg cells that are fertilized simultaneously, and from each egg cell, two babies form, right? Those are different among each other, like you would be different. This is, imagine that your brother or sister were born at the same time, like you look years later or years before, right? The other way to have twins is that a single fertilized egg cell starts dividing, but very early on, this ball of cells separates, and from each part, a new baby is formed. Those are then called identical twins, because initially there's a one genetic material, and now they're just two creatures with the same genetic material. Now, in this process of splitting, sometimes it's not perfect, and then you would have two babies trying to develop, but they're still connected somehow. And then you would have conjoined twins, and they can be joined with a head or other parts of the body.
Maggie, did you want to say something?
No.
Okay. Colton?
So when the identical twins split from the same egg, do they have half of the DNA that they they would initially have, or does it
no, it's my turn.
I might need to hear this again. Please tell me.
He was wondering about the genetic composition of each of the two twins. Like, he was wondering if you separate these embryos and they grow into their individual selves, do they only have half the DNA?
No, they have full DNA. Because each cell, when it divides, has full DNA. It's just the ball of cells that splits in two. So it's the number of cells is half, not the amount of DNA within those cells. So the identical twins, the separation is at the cellular level, not within the cell.
Great question. Okay, next question. How are twins normally made?
Yeah.
The question is, how are twins more commonly made?
Non-identical.
This
is what I answered earlier. If you have two egg cells coming up instead of one egg cell, and then two different spermatozoa fertilize each of those egg cells. So that's, and then you have basically two completely genetical different babies growing at the same time.
Are you guys?
This is, for example, in humans, humans usually have one baby. Twins or triplets rarely happen, right? But some animals give many babies at the same time, right? Like mice can have anything between 6 and 12 babies at the same time. That means that there are multiple egg cells fertilized at the same time. Or like dogs and cats, they have multiple offspring, right? So that's that.
Next question. Next question. Jen?
So with conjoined twin, you said that sometimes they'll conjoin by the head. Couldn't they read each other's thoughts?
I don't surface connection, you know, if it's at the level of skin or bone maybe, if it's deeper connection, I don't think that that brain could function. So, sorry to disappoint you, but I don't think that would work. Sometimes if they are conjoined in a different part of the body, they would have two heads.
Yeah.
And those, I guess, each would think a bit different. This is kind of having a fight with your own self, right? It's probably complicated to live like that. Yeah, but I'm not that familiar with how this exactly works. Sometimes they would have one heart, for example, or two heads. This is problematic because you can't separate them, right?
Max?
So how do, like, outside things, like you hear about smoking and alcohol, how does that actually affect the embryo?
Oh, that's a very good question, and sadly, that can affect embryo really badly. So, for example, smoking, in general, when a person smokes, the blood vessels kind of constrict a little bit. They narrow. This can then, if a mother smokes when she's pregnant, this can also happen in the developing embryo or fetus, right? And you don't want that because if you constrict the blood vessels, then the flow of blood that carries oxygen and various nutrients for the embryo is limited. So the embryo will not have enough food or the oxygen to develop properly. Usually those babies are born smaller than average. So try avoid smoking. That's kind of generally good.
Yeah.
It is less so if a pregnant woman just stands next to someone who smokes, but, and you know, if it's repetitive, if someone in household smokes all the time, then this effect, even if it's less so, it still can be visible.
What about like alcohol?
So, alcohol as such, wine is not a problem, but when alcohol degrades in the organism, it degrades in two steps, and usually the middle product is toxic. So if that gets circulation and gets to the baby, it can be kind of toxic to the baby cells. So that's different mechanism of toxicity.
Does anyone have any? What if two sperm cells make it to an egg?
So the egg has a mechanism that once first sperm hits it, it immediately creates a protective shield. We call it zona pellucida, and that then repels all the other sperms. They kind of, ping, you know, kind of are being repelled from it. So it cannot happen that two sperms fertilize one egg cell. It's a very neat mechanism, actually. This process happens really quickly upon fertilization with the first sperm.
Neat. Alex?
So, talking about conjoined twins, I just had a small thought. How does alien hand syndrome develop?
The question is about something called alien hand syndrome. I've never heard of that, though.
It's where your arm moves on its own and you can't control it.
Are there, ladies and gentlemen, are there any final questions for Dr. Mirna? Any final questions? We have moved into our next unit on fossils and geologic time, and we were talking about amber and how living things could be trapped and then fossilized in amber. And of course, Jurassic Park came up. Is there any fact base to that? Is there any way, is the DNA in good enough condition to extract from amber? Has anyone done that, do you know?
I don't think has anyone done that. The oldest that I know of DNA extracted from fossils Neanderthals. So those are human species that existed 30,000 years ago and before that. So for a period of time in history, our human species that we call Homo sapiens coexisted with other humans. Now, this is something that is difficult to comprehend for us because we are all in the world one species. But this is like having, you know, there's an African and Asian elephant. They exist at the same time. Or there are different species of finches, little birds, for example, different species of ants. So at some point in history, we were not exception to that rule. We had this other human species coexisting with us. And Neanderthals went extinct about 30,000 years ago. And some years ago, DNA was extracted from those bones. Usually the best is to take DNA from the teeth because teeth are very durable and they kind of shield the DNA the pulp in the middle. I don't think you will get any DNA from animals trapped in anywhere. Because DNA exposed like this